The coronavirus outbreak. This is no longer a problem for China. It's a problem for the world.
Everyone wants to know what's going on. I mean, I don't want to panic, but it could become a global pandemic.
Just how much will this novel coronavirus spread going forward? The official answer is only time will tell. But in this video, I'm going to give you my prediction about what is going to happen with the coronavirus, or COVID-19, as it's now being called. As of right now, there are only 14 confirmed cases in the United States, but unfortunately, it looks like there's going to be a wave of infection coming in the US and other countries as well. And I'm not the only doctor who thinks this is the case. Dr. Nancy Missoni, director of the CDC's National Center for Immunization and Respiratory Diseases, expects it to take a foothold in the US. And, quote, at some point, we're likely to see community spread in the US or in other countries. This will trigger a change in our response strategy, she says. And what about Dr. Tom Frieden, the former director of the CDC, who just the other day wrote an article, who also thinks that spread is likely? Just look at this alarming study from JAMA, the Journal of American Medical Association, on how fiercely it spread in the Chinese hospital. It quickly spread to healthcare workers and other patients in the hospital. Specifically, of the 138 patients who were in this Chinese hospital with coronavirus pneumonia, 57 of them caught the infection while already in the hospital for other reasons. And keep in mind, these numbers are being underreported.
China is being accused of censoring critical data about the coronavirus, which the World Health Organization now calls a grave threat to the world. According to scientists writing for the Lancet Medical Journal, Chinese authorities had preliminary information on the virus for more than 2 weeks before it was officially released. One citizen journalist documenting the outbreak in Wuhan, that's the city at the center of the outbreak, has reportedly been arrested. Another has just disappeared.
Wow. So you know the numbers in China are really higher than what's being reported. The numbers are also underreported because it's actually hard to test everyone due to limited resources like testing kits, etc. They even started making the diagnosis based on symptoms and CAT scan results. More on that in a bit. But based on the numbers that we already do have, let's take a look. So this is the Johns Hopkins coronavirus tracker. These are the numbers as of the making of this video. So as of right now, there's 60,363 total confirmed cases in the world. The vast majority, mainland China. 14 are in the United States. The leading country besides China, Singapore with 58 cases. The total number of deaths globally, 1,370. So this data is based on numbers coming from the World Health Organization, the CDC, and others as well. This is the total number of deaths graphed out. So back in January 23rd, you see the rise steadily. This is an upward trend here, and it shows over 1,000 as of February 12th. Then you have the number of daily deaths in this graph, and you can see that the number of daily deaths keeps increasing, and it took a big jump on February 12th. So based on the numbers and the study that I just showed you and other studies like this one, it's looking like there's going to be a wave of secondhand spread of the virus, meaning it's likely only a matter of time before the spread occurs from someone who hasn't been directly connected to Wuhan or directly connected to someone who has a confirmed case of coronavirus. In fact, we already have evidence that it's spreading in people without even having symptoms. So here's my prediction. Unfortunately, a certain percentage of the population will get hit with this wave of coronavirus. Fortunately, most people who get infected will only have cold or flu-like symptoms. Only a tiny fraction of infected patients will end up with pneumonia. Only a small fraction of those pneumonia patients will end up with ARDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. Check out my video on ARDS to get a better understanding of what it is and how we treat ARDS patients. So, here is a normal chest x-ray. The black represents air within the lungs, and this is normal. This is a chest x-ray of a patient with coronavirus pneumonia in the state of Washington, the first case of coronavirus in the United States. Notice this opacification right here, this white opacification, because that's indicative of an infiltrate. And in the right clinical context, you could call that a pneumonia. And because it's coronavirus in this case, we call it coronavirus pneumonia. So here's another case of coronavirus pneumonia. This is in a patient in Vietnam. Here, this guy has extensive pulmonary opacities, extensive infiltrate in his left lung here. Extends all the way from his left upper lobe, lingula, and left lower lobe. Right lung, pretty much nothing. And now let's take a look at what ARDS looks like on the chest x-ray. Here it is, both lungs. You could notice hardly any black, meaning pretty much all of his lungs are just completely opacified with dense infiltrate. Now, these bilateral patchy opacities, or bilateral fluffy infiltrates, is one part of making the diagnosis of ARDS. So now we'll take a look at a CAT scan of someone with healthy lungs. At the top, working our way down from the head towards the feet, all the black represents air. Those squiggly lines are the blood vessels. This is all normal. Just all normal lung. Now, this is a CAT scan of someone with bilateral fluffy infiltrates on CAT scan. So far, the lungs look normal, but as we come down, you start to see this grayish appearance. This is what we call a ground glass opacity. This ground glass opacity represents parenchymal disease, parenchymal inflammation. That's where the alveoli are partially or completely filling up with fluid and or inflammation. So as we come down further and further, you'll notice more and more ground glass opacification. And you can see air bronchograms. So this is the airways. And then when you get outside the airways into the air space where the alveoli are, that's where you have this ground glass opacification. And you see it in both lungs, and it's patchy. Ground glass opacities is a descriptive term referring to an area of increased attenuation in the lung on a CAT scan with preserved bronchial and vascular markings. It's a nonspecific radiologic finding with lots of different etiologies. So it only helps in making a diagnosis. In other words, it doesn't make any diagnosis just by itself. So truly, you never see pneumonia on chest x-ray or CAT scan. Instead, you see airspace opacification. You can only call it pneumonia if it fits the clinical context of the patient based on symptoms, etc. Now, not every coronavirus patient with ARDS is guaranteed to die, but they have a high likelihood of dying. Based on the early numbers of all the patients with coronavirus, it appears that the mortality rate is around 2% or so. But what can we do to make sure that this number is as low as possible? In my opinion, there's four main factors. One, implement infection control measures. So this includes isolating infected patients, using personal protective equipment when necessary, hand washing, etc. Okay, number two, early recognition of symptoms, recognizing fever, runny nose, sore throat, cough, body aches, etc. Number three, early diagnosis. I realize right now the CDC has certain criteria for who to test, which is a person with symptoms and someone who's recently been to Wuhan area, or who's someone who's been in close contact with a confirmed case. But at some point, we'll cross that threshold where we'll have to broaden the criteria of who we test, because some people will get the coronavirus via secondhand exposure. Diagnosis is based on symptoms, travel and exposure history, lymphopenia in the blood work, getting a CAT scan or chest x-ray, but the diagnosis is clinched when you do the real-time PCR testing. Okay, number four, possible early antiviral treatment. Hear me out. Compassionate use of the new antiviral drug, remdesivir. That's what I'm talking about. I talk about this drug in another video, so check it out for more details. In order to get this drug, doctors have to apply for it. They have to apply for compassionate use of the drug. This is because it hasn't even undergone a placebo randomized controlled trial yet. And this drug may only be available in limited amounts because it's new and has not undergone mass production. Actually, update, as of today, it's now being mass produced in China, as well as the United States pharmaceutical company Gilead. And because this drug is likely to have very limited availability, at least initially, we'll have to be very selective of who gets it. We'll want to reserve it for patients who are most likely to benefit from it, in which the potential benefit outweighs the risk. By the way, it appears to be safe, but we just don't know just how safe it is. So we're not going to want to give it to people who only have mild illness. But then again, given to someone who is critically ill in the ICU with ARDS might not have benefit either, because lots of times with viral infections like influenza, they only respond to antiviral medication if given early in the disease course. So the sweet spot, if you will, of who to give it to would be those who have moderate or severe illness when the diagnosis is made sooner rather than later. The bottom line is the clinical decision to administer the drug will be done on a case-by-case basis. The problem with that is how many people are going to require it? Will it be a few cases here and there? Or will it be hundreds or thousands? So as of right now, The coronavirus is an epidemic in the continent of Asia. It's not a pandemic because it hasn't become an epidemic in two continents. Hopefully, it doesn't become a pandemic. I think in the next week or so, we'll have a good idea if this epidemic is peaking or not. If sustained transmission begins in other countries, which unfortunately seems pretty likely at this point, if that happens, it's unlikely that it can be contained. So I do think this will end up being a pandemic. But I don't think it's all doom and gloom. I don't think every state will look like Hainan Province. I don't think every big city will look like Wuhan. In the end, I don't think it will be as bad as the current flu, which there's actually 22 million cases this season and 12,000 deaths from the flu. But I'm curious about what you think. Leave a comment below on what you think is going to happen. Also, if you like this video, give it a like because it encourages me to make more videos. Anyway, regardless of what happens, let's do our best to be prepared, minimize the spread of disease, and also let's stay educated. Check out my video on how to prevent the flu because not only can you learn how to prevent the flu, but also those same infection measures are used to prevent getting the coronavirus. Also, for more details on the new antiviral drug remdesivir, check out my video on that as well. See you in the next one.